Honorable Subuddhi sir, and I am requesting the participants to please take note of the important points. Please don't share your screen. Please don't unmute your mic unnecessarily. Whenever you have a question or if you have any doubts, if you have anything to share, please go ahead, type in the chat box. We will discuss each and every question at the end of the talk of our resource person. And we are also recording this session so that we can use it further. So I formally, officially, in my personal capacity and as a representative of the university, I thank and welcome my guru, Subuddhi sir, and I formally request him to kindly take over and deliver the session. Thank you, sir. Over to you. Sir, kindly unmute your mic and then start speaking. We are not able to hear anything from your side, sir. Sir, kindly unmute. It can only be done from your end, sir.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
A very good afternoon, Professor Mantri and Dr. Anshuman and other colleagues and dear participant friends.
Very good afternoon, sir.
And my slides, could you all see these? Hello, Anshuman, can you help me?
Sir, you have to share your screen once again.
Okay.
Sir.
Is it now okay?
Yes, sir, it is visible now.
So sorry for the delay, and at the outset, I must thank the university, Professor Mantri, Dr. Anshuman, and all colleagues. So today, I'm really thankful, and Anshuman actually has spoken something more, which I don't deserve actually, that is his nicety. So without wasting any further time, let me briefly start with what I plan to cover today, and with a small request to Dr. Anshuman. Anshuman, am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are
so
audible.
You have to stop me if I'm like running out of time or if I'm not audible. So my phone is also on. You have to help me. So here it goes. I'll be today just giving few examples so that may have a trigger kind of thing with all participants, all students, and all future scholars, so that they can take off their future research and also the completion of this particular paper in a better way, and they perhaps can enjoy doing research. So the session plan for this paper, which will be handled by me and my colleague, Sumita, Professor Sumita Mishra. After today's session, second session, third session will be like this: a review of literature, and she'll also be talking on sampling and qualitative data analysis. So here is Sumita, just like you can have a view kind of thing. And my role will be after today's intro kind of thing. In the intro, I'll be covering mostly the examples, why we'll be doing research, how I'll be doing research, and I'll be covering the research process and few concepts today I'll be covering on data itself. And after Sumita's two sessions, my four sessions will be on research design and quantitative data analysis, and will be using SPSS or Excel or both. So this is what like my plan, and I will be loving to share a good news about both of us, and that this will also be summarized in the last session, session number 5, that we have come out with a good book on research methodology, which has come this year, January 2020, and this book has been published by Emerald. And we are happy to share with all the students here. So this is how Sumita and me have teamed up for research methodology since last 5 to 7 years. Now coming to the fundamentals of research, I'll be also giving in particular examples to development research. We'll be mostly covering today why a research and what is a research, and maybe like briefly how to do, how to start a research. This will be my first focus, and we'll be covering in due course of time today's presentation few basic concepts relating to development research. And in my area of interest, I'll be talking on the data needs and basic concepts of data. Now to start with, why one should do a research. As we all are postgraduates, we are having some idea at least that research should be defined as one activity which should lead to knowledge creation. Knowledge is something which is new, which we were not knowing. For that, we wanted to find something new, and that is part of research. I'll also add, if we take our research as a matter of self-satisfaction, as a matter of self-motivation, then only the research will be very, very interesting. So I have to put this, that research should be self-motivated, self-satisfying also, that I am creating some new knowledge. And those who will be going further and maybe like publishing some research output, we should also from the beginning take little bit care so that the research result should be worthy of publishing, and at the same time our research should be memorable to us. Now to make it memorable, to make it interesting, to make it publishable, I think personally, if we get a good research topic, that's a good start. Getting a good idea, getting good research topic is actually key to research. So how to get good ideas or good research topics? It is usually comes in two ways. Either it is given or decided. Something like, say, for example, some of us have taken project, government is asking, do this, and here is the fund. Today, I have got one like mail from ICSSR, Government of India, can we do something collaborative research on Corona or COVID pandemic? So if the topic is decided, so it is half done, so I need not worry much. Or if it is not given, so we have to select ourselves. That is called self-driven. So if we observe or refer literature and look to the current trends, particularly the daily happening observations, and we get some insights or some guided ideas. So this is possible if we continuously read current magazines, newspapers, or even refer web resources. Today I'll be giving sufficient examples so that like all of us can have some idea how do we generate new research topic. So how to get interesting topics? When I'm talking of research ideas or topics, we also mean that we should have some researchable issues or research questions. If it comes to our mind as a researchable question, what will happen? How do I do it? What will be the result? So then that type of question asking can finally be converted to research issues. I'll be giving some ideas, some examples, so that it will be clearer. To get this, my suggestion is we need to read journals and news magazines and keep track of the latest trends. Say, for example, as all of you might have guessed, I should start with the most hot topic in today's parlance is about the corona crisis, which is called COVID-19 crisis. So can it be taken as a possible research area? We take the crisis or the fatalities. Say, for example, if I refer latest data, which I was referring today morning, world over, we have got like 35 lakh corona cases. And unfortunately, more than 2.5 lakh died. But the silver lining is that more than 11 lakh have recovered. And if you look at some finer data in India, I'm just referring today's morning data, whatever COVID cases, corona cases we have in India, if you look to the statistics, over 70% of the cases are from the towns, urban areas, urban local bodies. So we should ask why it happens. When I'm asking why it happens, maybe like some of my participant friends must be having immediate answer, because there is high concentration, lot of economic activities. There may be some apparent answers. Beyond apparent answers, can you also have some like unanswered questions? Say, for example, why the varying concentrations at few cities? Say, for example, for the benefit of all participant friends, let's take two states. I'm not talking of Mumbai or Pune kind of thing. Say, for example, Madhya Pradesh and Odisha. Madhya Pradesh, as you all know, capital is Bhopal, but Indore is high, having very high fatalities, very high casualties. High stress is from Indore, not from Bhopal, though it is state capital. We know that Indore is the commercial capital of Madhya Pradesh. Now, when you talk of Odisha, let's take like say Cuttack and Bhubaneswar. Bhubaneswar is state capital and Cuttack is commercial capital. And as of today, we all know that Cuttack is in green zone, and unfortunately, Bhubaneswar is now again in red category. So why this varying concentration? So when we take it as a question kind of thing, research question, now further question comes, can it be part of some exploratory research? Can it be just descriptive research where we like describe with some like macro level data kind of thing? Or can we have some quantitative data analysis? Say, for example, I'll be showing you today's data, which I collected today from different websites. I'll be showing you two graphs now. One on new cases per day, and second on the total cumulative total till today. The first graph, as you see from this, can we guess that the total fatalities, deaths, is it like something like we have reached the peak and it is plateauing, or nothing can be told? So can we have a some like predictive analysis kind of thing? The same figure, if you put it in cumulative total, it looks like this. So data can be interesting, and maybe like possibly we can have different type of research. I'll be giving my second example. This is a project which I really liked, and I visited 2 months back with my present batch of research scholars. That is a very interesting concept. I don't know whether those who are listening to me have heard of this concept called nutrition garden, and this is part of Odisha Livelihood Mission, and they have done it along with Ajim Premji initiative. This is actually called Mo Upokari Bagicha, and in many rural areas, I guess like more than 950 selected villages they have already started, and they are looking to why rural area mothers are suffering from malnutrition and which is perhaps leading to child vulnerability. So we had a field study just 2 months back. Luckily, we got one research scholar participant. Can I continue?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So this is a project actually, the joint initiative of Ajim Premji Philanthropic Initiative and OLM. And we visited along with the recent batch of my scholars. And one of the scholars is actually the chief manager of this project. So he had invited and we had like a chance of visiting that. Say, for example, if government is having such intervention plan, how effective is such intervention plan? And what more possibly could be done? And say, for example, will it be a case of qualitative survey research, or will it be fitting into a longitudinal study, or can you also go for impact study? So this type of question, when we discuss through this example, later I will be going to this type of research. So before going straight to the definition concept of type of research, through these examples, I'm just like presenting before the participant friends here so that they can have interest and they can think for a while, this particular example, will it have qualitative or quantitative analysis kind of thing? Say, can it also be part of experimental research? And I'll be just like happy to share some pictures taken by me, which we visited this project very recently, 2-3 months back. And as you can see, I'm part of this project visit kind of thing. And this left-hand side photo is the present batch of our PhD scholars of kid management. Say, for example, next example, I'll be talking of, all of you perhaps can see this screen. The title of this particular slide, if you read without the question mark, and I put it a full stop, pollution kills, full stop. And if you read it with a question mark, pollution kills. So you ask to yourself, can pollution be fatal? Can it really kill people? So if you put it in a, replace it by full question mark and not by full stop, this becomes a researchable issue kind of thing. I'll be just like sharing some facts. So these are the like observations which we had found last year in leading journals. And if you can please recall, few months back, Delhi, Mumbai, and other, it was really, pollution was the worst level. And thank God, indirectly to Corona, and everything is silenced, and we are really, nature has prevented, and pollution is not there. And that is, I think, the only positive side of Corona pandemic. Now, what I'm presenting now here is, whether it is ICMR report, whether it is newspaper report, or maybe like down to earth report. So everywhere you read for yourself that they are having observation or conclusion. Say, for example, air pollution killed these many Indians. And say, for example, first line, air pollution kills a child every 3 minutes in India, full stop. So this is one conclusion. But if you read the last line, pollution can be linked to mortality. So this is coming as a proposition, or you can modify it as one hypothesis. This is something like a research or this statement. The first three statements are conclusions, and the last sentence to me is a bit interesting, so that I can carry forward possibly for a research project. Now the interesting here is what our minister observed. Please all of you read here. Our minister, if you can read his name here, he just observed last year, October 2019. he just concluded that there is no correlation between pollution and this life fatality kind of thing. And the day he commented this, next day there was a severe comment from WHO that his comment is fallacious and untenable. These are like called the research statements. Without verifying, how can you say that there is no link? There is no correlation. So from this, what I'm suggesting is, it is worthy of doing research. Now this similar kind of thing somebody has found, North Indian cities are more polluted than South Indian cities. I'll not be wasting time here. And next example, I'll be just like presenting something, a lovely concept called MoCycle. As you all know that this was launched 2 years back, I think 2018 latter part we had this, and that was a dream project of our present chief minister when we had actually international hockey match here. And those who recall, within 2 months, entire city, all tracks were painted red, entire city. It's a huge project, and we had GPS system and public bicycle sharing apps kind of thing. All were really very, very enthusiastic about this concept and all welcome kind of thing. But just after 2 months, news came like this. Dozens of motorcycles go missing in Bhubaneswar. Here is one English news, and those who can read Odia, this reads like this: Thokongko kabjare motorcycle. That means the users have outsmarted the smart city smart cycles. Now, why do? Can it be taken as a social issue? Can it be taken as a technical issue? Or can you take as a problem solving applied research kind of thing? So if somebody takes it as a social issue research, what should be the methodology? What type of research I should have? Should I go for a mixed research method or experimental research method? So if you remember these examples, I think the classification of research will be easier to remember. I'll be presenting 2-3 more examples, then I'll be coming back to the concept definitions. Somebody studied social distance, emotional distance between father and son. I think Anshuman or something like older participants, older than Anshuman, can please recall how we were respecting or how much we are afraid of our fathers when we are kids. But gone are those days. Now, the gap between a father and son has been breached. Father and son or father and daughter, they're best friends. I can recall my childhood, I was very much afraid to talk to my father. So now, over ages, over years, this distance is getting breached. Just like imagine, observe how interesting this social research somebody has done, and this was published in research journals and also newspaper. Next is something to the field of human resource. If you please read the title of this slide, please read carefully the first sentence, and also please take care about the first word and the last word. First word is elevation, last word is care. So two concept or construct, or I can say variables. Elevation leads to caring nature. Somebody has found it. If employees are given timely elevation, timely promotion, timely promotion or incentives, they in turn take more care of their subordinates. So the observation or the research conclusion was elevation makes people more caring. So this is what like something a finding, and this I can skip how one exploratory research has found that unless we verify the secondary statistic like this, we cannot know how skewed, how tilted our family planning schemes are. And are these information gives, more females are forced for sterilization, which is something like a bad. So this was happened till 2015-16 kind of thing. I think things have changed. Unless we study these issues, we cannot prescribe, we cannot suggest the planners. So now coming again, whatever we are given through these examples, please recall what we started today. I suggested that let the research be self-motivated and self-satisfying. And finally, we should not forget that every research should end at creating some new knowledge. Then let's now come, how do we define research? How do we understand research? Once we understand the definition of research, which I'm pretty sure all of you must be knowing, then we'll be moving forward to the research process part. As all of you may be knowing better than me, research is something like systematic, structure, sequential method of study or inquiry. It is directed towards a very clear objective that we have to create some new knowledge. That is called research. Such study, such inquiry, which you call research, may lead to two things. One, either you are using some existing theories to solve some existing problem, which you'll be calling applied research, problem-solving research, or you are creating, generating, developing new theories, new models. This is called theoretical research or basic research. This can also be defined as, I'm sure this slide will be shared with all participants, so you need not note it down. Just, if possible, please read it along with me when I'm just narrating, explaining kind of thing. It is just a search or investigation for knowledge. Whenever I'm using knowledge, it is something, a new idea, new knowledge. And perhaps either we solve problem or we develop new theories, which we have told earlier. So again, another way of defining it, this may comprise of set of techniques, principles for systematically collecting, recording, analyzing data and its meaningful interpretation. This is what we can also define a research is. Now, when you talk of development research or developmental research, as one can guess, how much is the development and the issues relating to developmental research can be part of this DRM. Say, for example, governments have so many schemes, and a particular scheme which is aimed at lower strata, and in lower strata also we have got different subsections. Very low income or middle income, or even also like high income neighborhoods. So every scheme, if you study the intervention, I'm sure all of you will agree with me that the impact will not be uniform. Across the different sections of socioeconomic strata, it may be like varying. So it will be something interesting to study. Or we can also like take that nutrition garden example, which will be a befitting example of developmental research. Now let's come to the research process. First will be very briefly discuss about the different stages, which you also call the steps of research. Then we'll go for classification of different types of research or categories. So as you may be knowing better, every research should start with problem identification. What is the issue? What do we want to do? So we have to define that research problem, research issue, in terms of very clear objectives. It could be broad objective, and it can possibly have clearer sub-objectives also. So this is the stage one or step one. Once we are clear about the objectives after problem identification, we should next think whether I am in need of data. If there is a need for data, then I have to clearly identify the data needs. We'll be discussing today different types of data. As for the requirement, we have to go for that particular type of data, not any data, what we will be getting. Then from where I should get the data, that is called data source. I'll be giving example, like say for example, whether a particular district is having high COVID-19 patients. As we have been seeing every day, news briefing at 4:30 by the bureaucrats, questions come to our mind, why Bhubaneswar is having high number of cases, why the Western Odisha is not having. Some of us may be thinking, is it something that we are not having sample test facility earlier in those areas? We have not tested, maybe, possibly, maybe, and we are not getting kind of thing. So is it the only thing that leads to identification of COVID patients? Those who might have read some serious news items with the due respect to religion, don't take me otherwise. A particular community few months back or few weeks back, those related to Nizamuddin, I'm not naming that religion kind of thing. The entire country had unfortunate suspicion. So, and the community had a complaint that why the sample testing is done on that community. Is the sampling bias that you are getting the data source from there? And so that was actually a flashed kind of thing. I'll be discussing when I'm talking, going to the sampling method, sampling bias kind of thing. So we have to be very careful from where I should collect data. So this is what one example, and I will not forget, I'll be elaborating further when I go for the data collection kind of thing. That will be called a sampling bias kind of thing. Next, we have the research design. This is very critical kind of thing. And what type of research, what will be the methodology of data collection? At this stage, we should be very clear. And once this is clear, done, then we have to think, am I going for a sample survey? Or am I allowed to collect data from the entire population? So sampling may not be the only choice. Given a chance, if I'm having all resources, all possibility of conversing or collecting data from the population, nothing like it. But many times, or most of the times, we don't have access to the population, or we don't have much resources for checking the entire population. So most of the research, 99.9%, are based on sample survey results. So we'll be giving a special session on sampling and sampling concepts. Next will be the collection of data. Once we collect data, then we go for the analysis and interpretation, and we make a good presentation of the research findings. So these are the few structured steps or stages of research process. Now let's move and discuss something about the types of research. On this section, I'll not be taking much time because I have already given some hints while I was explaining something about the examples. And again, it will be repeated when I'm further taking specific example cases so that I can give example here. From one angle, broadly you can classify research into two ways, which you have already covered, of course. Basic research or theoretical research. Second is applied research, which we'll be calling problem solving research. Again, from another angle, we can classify research into yet to another type of research, depending on the type of data that we are dealing, depending upon the analysis that we are carrying out. One could be qualitative research, another could be quantitative research. As one can guess, when you are dealing with qualitative data, it is part of qualitative research. And whenever we are dealing with quantitative data, it will be quantitative research. But please remember, there are many research which will be dealing both qualitative and quantitative. So please don't think that it will be either this or that, nothing like that. A research can also have both the type qualitative and quantitative. Again, from another angle, literature classifies research into two ways. One, exploratory research. Exploratory research is particularly required on areas where we don't have any sufficient literature, where we don't know much about the topic. I can give the current example, my example number one on corona. Those who are following social media, most or newspapers, must be reading something like a very scaring news items that this coronavirus, when it is getting transformation or mutation, it takes different forms and it's really something fearful. So what happens when it mutates or takes the mutation in different forms? So what would be its implications? Nobody knows. So in areas where we do not have much studies, we cannot stop thinking. Also, we cannot afford not doing research on that area. So in the areas where we are not having ideas but have to have research, those areas should be started first with exploratory research, where we gain some initial insights. By some exploratory research, we manage to try some, at least some ideas, some initial insights, which will be helping us further to go for the next stage of research, which is called conclusive research. Once we have got idea, then the research design methodology can be concrete and we can concretize our approach, then we can have a very conclusive report or research result. That type of research is part of conclusive research. One more method, which is part of development research also, the case study method, which is an in-depth examination of something which is of interest. It can be a person, a customer, it can be a panchayat. Now say, for example, we have given powers of a collector in a limited form with the sarpanch of a panchayat. So what happens when you empower them? What happens? You give some more funds. So it is something like interesting and we have to take it up as a research study. And to me, it will be a very interesting case study research method. And the example I have given, nutrition garden for mo upakari bhavicha kind of thing, or say Anganwadi cases, and so many cases like this. And if you get some like insight through this case study research, that will be leading to further research, which is called exploratory research. Now to summarize, this is a table which will helping my participant friends, particularly for their coursework. This is a tabular form of the classification which you have already explained. Basic research, applied research, exploratory and conclusive research. The last one, particularly I request all those who are listening to me, the last one, it is not casual research. All of you, please remember, it's a causal research. Descriptive research versus causal research. So all of you, those who are student friends, I particularly emphasize in my classes, in my management classes. So when you are interested to have cause and effect research, that is called causal research. Now let's come to my area of interest, that is data analysis. For data analysis, as one can guess, we need to be very clear. Do I have the need or requirement of data? Can I not manage any research without any data? To start with, all of us should be very clear. If we get good data, if we get quality data, then the data analysis, the result will be good. So quality of data is the key for a good result and good data analysis, which will be desired. I have put in quote desired. So whatever required, we have to go for the data analysis, not any data analysis for data analysis sake. This I'll be repeating in my next session when I cover data analysis. So what we just told, the criticality of data, which we can call the building blocks of any research. So here, I would suggest my participant friends to clarify their conceptual doubts, if any. I know that some of you are aware of some of the basic facts, but today it's my duty to very briefly cover basic concepts and differences relating to data. To start with, we must like clarify about the requirement of data. I'll be quickly covering. We have to be very clear about the exact need of data for the research. We have to ask ourselves, do I really need data? And what type of data? Is it qualitative data, quantitative data? That we'll be discussing a bit later. And what would be my source of data? We'll be giving a lot of examples later. So that is also very important for us. I need to know the source. And what would be the method of data collection? And what type of measurement scales I'll be using, which we will call instruments. So these are relating to data before you go for data types. Next is different classification definitions or types of data. As you all know, we can classify data into two ways, primary versus secondary data. I'm pretty sure all of you know better than me. Primary is the one which we are collecting for the first time. Secondary is which is readily available and we are using from public sources, which we call secondary sources. Those are called secondary data. And from another angle, we classify data into two ways, quantitative versus qualitative data. Qualitative data is also called categorical data. That we'll be repeating in my next session. And quantitative quality data we have already discussed. Next, please be remembering that in some research, we may be collecting ourselves some data, and in some cases, it is auto-generated. I'll be giving one example. Say, for example, a mall like Big Bazaar, Reliance Fresh kind of thing, you have got billing desk, and they will be continuously coming out bills, people buying different commodities. But end of the day, floor manager generate a particular consolidated bill where it shows how many toothpaste, how many soap, how many other items are sold. So it is automatically generated. You are not collecting it. Sometimes the data, it is reported to you or it is automatically generated. So you have to have idea. Sometimes we may not collect, it will be coming to us. Say, for example, I'll be sharing my hobby or bad hobby. Anshuman should not laugh at me. Say, all of you must be knowing, we have got CM relief fund, PM relief fund, particularly for COVID, Corona. And those who know that they are publishing very next day, who have donated, how much they have donated. And it is published in one Excel sheet. Every end of the day, I'm collecting it and automatically the total is generated there. So what I'm doing every day, I'm collecting how maybe like when the emotions of the people, public are high, total donations are high. Are the emotion flattened or died down? So the total amount of donations may perhaps decrease, kind of thing. So maybe like after 1-2 months, I'll just having one like exploratory research on how much, how often we donate to that type of crisis, kind of thing. So this is generated data. I'm not collecting from any source. Now next could be like experimental data, or what we observe ourselves without an experimentation. So we have got like two types of experimental data and observational data. I'll be devoting a couple of minutes on the particular classification called random data and purposive data. Those who might have heard Mr. Subrat Bagchi and his colleagues, those who are presenting continuously every day, they were answering to a public question. Why selectively, purposively they are collecting samples from selected areas? Why not randomly? The question comes, if you randomly select, maybe like possibly we can have like detection of corona patients from different areas which is not explored. But their justification is, when the testing facility is limited, if you are honestly wasting your energy in area where there is no actually infection, and you are wasting your testing facility there and you are not able to find. Say for example, you have got suspicion this area, say Jaipur, Bhadrak, Baleshwar, maybe like people are coming, there is migration here. If you take more sample there, because maybe like before 1 month, we were testing in a day maximum hundreds. Now, of course, we are testing in thousands. So if you are able to test 2,000, 3,000, 5,000 in a day, so you cannot waste your energy in area where you think there may not be any patient. So it is a purposive data collection from a particular area out of suspicion they are collecting. They are not collecting randomly. So please remember, it is not random data, it's a purposive data. Now, we may sum up like this. I may revise the importance of data collection, data need. Data should be a data. They are specific to the research objectives. We have to be very clear what I want to find in this research. If I understand clear my objectives clearly, then I can know this data will be required. So few questions I'm just like putting for myself, for yourself, which you needed to answer. These questions will help every researcher, every student to understand what type of data I should have for my research. First thing, do I really have some specific objective or issues? Next question, do I have a situation of testing hypothesis? Hypothesis is nothing but something, a refined form of proposition. Then do I have concept, constructs, or which you will be calling, defining, explaining later, operational variables? In the part of DRM, we'll be having distinction between concept, construct, and operational variables. Only when you feel, yes, I have concepts, yes, I have constructs, yes, I have some operational variables, then that may lead, yes, I will be measuring those variables. Now, how do I measure? Say, for example, anger. Say, for example, nutrition. Say, for example, affection of father towards son. So how do I measure this? Those are the concepts. Say, for example, development. How do I measure development? I'll be giving example a bit later today itself. So I need to know, how do I measure this? For this, should I have a particular scale for measurement? And all these questions, if we ask to ourselves, then maybe perhaps we can have fairer idea on the type of data that we may be needing for our particular research. Now coming to data collection method, we can have direct observation, which you will be calling observation method. Go find, observe, collect data. Or you have to observe in the long run, which you cannot collect, get at the very instant of time. Say for example, I'll be again repeating my first example, that is Mo Upokari Bagicha, nutrition garden. Government, they have asked different families by incentivizing that you devote your kitchen garden. We are giving you seed, we are giving you subsidy, and you have kitchen garden and grow vegetables for your own family. Let me clarify here that Mo Upokari Bagicha nutrition garden is family kitchen garden for which incentives are given. Every family, those who are interested, will be sowing a particular patch of their courtyard where they have to grow different variety of vegetables. Minimum 15 to 20 vegetables they must grow there. That is called bagicha or nutrition garden, which should come as food supplement. So that should not be the objective. Is this should a counter strategy to check malnutrition of mothers of rural areas. Now, if some families have really spent time and grown some like vegetables, how it has impacted? You cannot go and same day you can observe. You have to repeat your visit, and in the long run you have to observe whenever they are taking nutrition vegetable kind of thing. After a few weeks, after a few months, what are the changes kind of thing. So that is called longitudinal study, where you have to have repeated measurements. Now coming to the different scales, how we'll be measuring. Broadly, we have got four basic fundamental scales. I repeat, four basic fundamental scales. First, and the most elementary, is nominal scale. Next, ordinal scale. Next, interval scale. Next, ratio scale. Those who may be knowing, it will be clear for them, but rest those who may not be knowing these scales, I'll be devoting a couple of minutes here. Nominal scale is something, a name, category. Say for example, religion. Say for example, different economic categories. So we brand and categorize by naming something, and it doesn't have any numerical value. Say for example, this is a minority class or backward class. So if you categorize different category, it will be your unit of observation. If some intervention plan schemes are there, how it is impacting that category. So that's why we have to also scale them in different categories. That is called nominal scale, which is nothing but some names, no numerical value. Next bit higher is called ordinal scale, when we put it in order or ranking. Say for example, we have got like packaged water bottle. Say 5-7 brands are there. Suppose say for example, Bisleri, I like the most. So to me, this is number one. So the most preferred, when the preference ratings vary, so we have to put it in order. First rank, second rank, third rank. Even your open university may be like having a evaluation, so they can put it in order. First student, second student, third student. This is just something like higher than nominal scale. It's just not name. So they are putting some values. This fellow is the top ranked student. So they are putting it in order. So this is called ordinal scale, which will be using some ranks, first, second kind of thing. Slightly higher version of scale is called interval scale. When we put some values within a range, say for example, if we compare two prime ministers, people start giving, say out of 10 score. These two prime minister one, 7.5 out of 10 scale. These two prime minister two, 6.1. let's not name the Prime Minister, or say, for example, ratings of the apps, if you find, or ratings of the Ola driver, what you find, those are interval scales within, say, for example, 4.7, a particular Ola driver. So that is in interval scale. And best example, if it comes in your exam, will be CGPA. Out of 10, say, for example, this student has got 8.2 CGPA, that student has got 7.1. So those CGPA is the best possible example of interval scale. Next is the highest form of scaling measurement, that is called ratio scale, which is put in absolute numbers. It can be fractional. My height, today's temperature, my income, how many students are attending now. Say, for example, 111 students are participating now, or 60 students are there. So 60, 111, there is no range, there is no order, there is no nominal. So it is a pure number. So this is called ratio scale. So these are the basic four fundamental scales. We'll be again, in another session, we'll be going for some hybrid scales. We'll be telling you later. Now I'll be, I think I have almost taken more than 55 minutes, I guess. Or someone should give me a time or kind of thing. I'll be taking 4-5 minutes more. Then we'll be taking a few questions. Now I'll be again putting towards end of my presentation, I'll be taking few issues. I'll be requesting all participant friends to think for a while for themselves. If this is the issue, this I want to study, this I want to do research, how do I do research? How do I measure it? Do I have to have qualitative data? Do I have to have quantitative data? Once we have discussed prior examples, followed by the definitions, concepts, now again I'm repeating two or three examples where you are expected to think in a refined way and you should have answers. I'll be happy if you have answer yourself. You should decide this particular piece of research will need, yes, qualitative data, qualitative research, or quantitative data, quantitative research, or both. Let me tell example one. Suppose UGC or Ministry of HRD or AICT, they have now role or duty or responsibility of ranking different institutes in universities. Now there is a huge challenge for all employees of universities and university administrator. Their ranks should be good. University X is better than University Y. IIT X is better than IIT Y. How they're rating it? Now, how it is compared? How they are measuring it? Now, for example, to be specific, if we now discuss about the research quality of institute, and next example, I'll be taking the research quality of individual researcher. Can we measure it? You ask to yourself. First example, can we quantify and measure research quality of one institute? Say, for example, IIT Bhubaneswar, KIIT, XIM, Utkal University, or other university, or IIM Sambalpur. Can we make a comparison? So research quality, if you talk to the term quality, is it a qualitative data? How do we measure this? Now, there is no definite answer, let me tell you, let me admit. Different scholars have viewed in different ways. I'll be presenting two, three approaches, views of scholars, including one of mine. And please enjoy this type of research approach. Say, for example, if you're interested in research quality, two things are there. How many research papers? That is quantity of research paper and quality of research paper. Not many research paper, but a very good research paper. So when you're talking of quality research paper, perhaps you are referring to impact factor. So those who are senior students or senior scholars must be understanding what is the meaning of research impact. And we have got citations also. This is one of the paper which I refer in my research methodology class. This is one of my friend from XIM Bhubaneswar, Viresh Rao professor. He's a good professor of economics, and this paper I can share later. And as you can see from the title here, Viresh and his team, they have studied all papers published during 1968 to 2015. Imagine, 1968 till 2015, all papers. Imagine the quantum of papers they have like analyzed. So their affiliation, they have like tabulated, and from there they have come up with most research productive institute, is most research productive professor. So those who are interested to know research strength of institute or teacher, they may go for articles like this. Also, out of my interest, I was also studying this kind of thing, how to measure research strength of the institute. What I've done, actually, I as my methodology, there is one website, maybe like some of you must be knowing, ResearchGate. In ResearchGate, different institutes are constantly observed and they're given scores. That is called RG score. So I was like observing every fortnight, as you see this slide. For 2014 and 15, I was observing every fortnight. Who are the top institutes in Asia? Who are the top institutes in India? And who are the top institutions in Odisha? This is a part of my exploratory research. So if you see the number, first column, second column, third column, these are all ratio skills which you have covered, pure numbers. So from this number, one can compare. Say, for example, one from China, one from Tokyo, one from like say Kyoto, those are the leading research or the institutes. Similarly, in 2014-15, when I studied this, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, was the top research institute in India. Now coming to individual research kind of thing, this is something like old data, and I have like highlighted, those who may be knowing, those who have some idea about the citation factor. I'm pretty sure Anshuman is doing well, and Professor Mantri also must be knowing. And my young participant friends, those who are interested, can please search any teacher, any scholar on Google Scholar. You can like find the list of articles he or she has published. I'm not a good scholar, though Anshuman took more than 5 minutes to praise, because once upon a time, perhaps accidentally, I taught him for a few months. But my citation, it is some 3 months back citation. Whatever I've done, whatever good, bad, garbage, the total citation is only 41, as you can see here. So this is, I can say, my score is only 41. So if you see, like say, my immediate PhD scholar, Professor Brajavallabh Kerr, he's having higher citation 55. He's doing better research kind of thing. So now in present market, one can compare Subbuddhi with Braja, and we can clearly say Braja is better than R.N. Subbuddhi. Or say, for example, Sumita will be having a better, or my colleague Sasmita, who is having more than 400 citations. Or one of my MBA students from Barampur, Manoj, it's some 3 months old data. I guess like he has crossed 750 odd citations. From this, you can know the impact of his research. So what I'm just suggesting here is, so how do we quantify a qualitative data? We started with quality of research, and I have taken the citation, which is a quantitative data. So now it's up to us how we design the research, how we collect the data. I started with a qualitative concept, and please remember, I'm using quantitative data. This is the duty of research. Next is our former vice chancellor, who was the vice chancellor of KIT University, Professor Mathur. He is having more than 6,000 citations. Now, you must be wondering, when we are less than 100, some people are having 1,000 citations, and they must be that time better. But don't take that. we belong to social science, they belong to pure science, and citations magnify better kind of thing. So that will be further discussed later. So this is not comparable actually, but if we take Professor Mathur's all publications, which is now more than 6,000 citation, but I'll be citing a single article of a person which is astonishingly more than 3 lakh citation. Those who have interest in finance area, economics area, might have read Fama's model. Now, a single article has been cited for 3 lakh articles. Now, here, let me clarify how it is so huge and how for us it is so less. Fama's article was published some 80 years back. So during the last 80 years, it is being repeated in geometrical progression. Suppose say 100 scholars cited 40 years back, then 40,000 scholar might have cited after 10 years. So it is getting increased here. So the citation is also positively related to the year of publication. When we uploaded our article very recently, naturally the citation will be less. Okay, so let's not devote much on that. My objective was, we can also design a research in such a way which may be apparently qualitative research, it can also be quantified. I can give so many examples which scholars may think, no, it cannot be quantified. But together, if we put our heads together, a qualitative research can be converted to quantitative research. And as you may please agree with me, quantitative research has got better appreciation and citation value. So this is what I had in session one. So over to Anshuman and Professor Mantri. Can you please coordinate? And if we can have questions, please.
Thank you so much, sir. So it was a wonderful and very precise session for us. And I hope all the friends, participants, and their colleagues understood very well. And you have explained and described with a burning example of COVID-19 and Amo Bagicha also. So that it is really, sir, very much learning for us and very much essential for us. So now, sir, could I take some questions?
Please. I'll be happy if I know, if I can answer. Please.
Okay.
I would like to interrupt, Prasha. I guess like this slide will be, this PPT will be shared with the participants.
Thank you so much, sir.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Please continue.
Sir, one question. Yes. How we verify quality of data?
Okay. Should I answer one by one, or you will be telling me all the questions?
As you wish, sir.
Okay. Let me try to answer this way. Quality of data. The simplest answer could be, as we are addressing student participants, most of the PG courses, some papers have got student projects. Those who remember, recall, or may guess, whenever a project is given, some questionnaire is generated, and the sum questionnaire is sent to some student. I'm using deliberately sum. Say, for example, I'll share my MBA student's example and my experience. You give any topic on mobile market or student's perception, the stock favorite respondent will be the student, those who are staying in the hostel, so that they can quickly collect the data. Imagine a topic is on Panchayat Raj, And the students have asked, MBA students, those who are in the hostel, and most of them are from urban cities. Maybe like most likely those students, those who are from metros, urban cities, they may not be having idea on the Panchayat Raj or Panchayat working kind of thing. And they will be giving some tick-tick kind of thing, data respondents. You get some questionnaire filled up and the data is actually not quality. Am I answering the question? So that will be a case of garbage in and garbage out. So we have to understand what is my target population. I'll give you one example. Say for example, sorry if I give some like marketing management example here, but I'll be trying to give some example which is very easy kind of thing. So second hand car market. As we all may guess, there is a market and people buy second hand car market. In second hand car market, one may go for a survey. How much should be the ideal pricing? What are the preferences of those who may be interested for second hand car? If this is the objective research issue, and if we collect from again students or anybody, I think that is not the target population. By target population means the population who should or would or may go for second-hand car may buy something in near future. Say for example, somebody, one of my student, because he or she loved me, sent the questionnaire. Now, as Anshuman is there, maybe like with permission of Professor Mantri, I can trouble Anshuman because some of the questions I had not asked Anshuman during his studentship. Say, for example, somebody sent me the questionnaire. So I should oblige, I should be part of the target population. The survey is second-hand car market. And we wanted to study the taste preference or how much price I may offer to buy a car market on those things. And the person who is serving has sent me the questionnaire. Sorry.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Good evening, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, my question was, to verify the quality of the data means, sir, in terms of the sampling.
Okay.
By doing the experimental work, the research work, mm-hmm. after collecting the data, how mm-hmm. we can verify this, that the data I have collected for research work is qualitative data?
No, qualitative data or the quality of data?
Quality of the data.
Give one example, specific example, please.
Any, sir, experimental work.
Give example, no? Give example. Take your time, give example. Experimental, yes. Research, you understand?
Yes, sir. Actually, I am a PhD student, sir.
Sorry, repeat.
Yes, sir, I understand.
Okay. Say, for example, in my RM class,
yeah,
I give example of experimental research, biting strength of crocodile. Okay.
Yes, sir.
If my research objective is to know what could be the highest biting strength of a wild crocodile, let me repeat the research question. What could be the highest biting strength of one wild crocodile? Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
So as part of experimental research, what I can do, I may try to catch some way or capture a crocodile. Agreed?
Yes.
So I'll be trying to insert one measuring instrument where I'll be teasing the crocodile, and crocodile might bite that instrument, where it will be captured the biting strength. That is called pound or square inch. That biting strength is measured automatically. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So when it is recorded, so biting strength is measured in PSI, pound for square inch. Suppose,
yes, sir,
at one bite, the crocodile I have caught given 895 PSI. Okay. So the 895 is the data part of my experimental research. Do you agree?
Yes, sir.
So now your question is, how do we verify the quality of our data?
Yes, sir. After getting the data, how we can verify it, this data?
Okay. So we should not forget what is my objective. My objective was, I should know what could be the highest form of biting strength of a wild crocodile. So the question comes, is it the highest form? Is it the ferocious form of the crocodile? Or should I tease the crocodile more so that it will be more angry, more biting, so it can go for the like 1000, 1100 kind of thing? Are you getting my point?
Yes, sir.
So 895 is actually something, a misleading value. So what I am doing, I'll be repeating the experiment. Suppose one time I got 895, another time I got 905, another time I got 1050. So similarly, after experimentation, my highest data is 1050 PSI. So which data I should collect or record?
In the average data?
Should I go for average or mode or maximum value? I guess if I am observing the highest possible biting strength, I should go for
the maximum.
For my point. Again, yes, the question will come. Suppose you and me together, we are writing a paper jointly. Okay, we are sending to one article, this article to one journal. The editor my question, is it the wildest animal or we should catch some fully grown crocodile? Are you getting my point?
Yes, sir.
So we have to have different species of crocodile. So quality of data in experimental research will vary kind of thing. Now coming to the COVID-19 cases, you must be aware different trial medicines are being experimented.
Yes, sir.
So they have to be very, very careful. This is part of experimental research, very clear.
Yes, sir.
Now, when you are suggesting the impact, so you have to care whether the patient on whom you have tried was normal or abnormal or already infected. So that will also hamper the quality of data. Am I making sense?
Yes, sir. By doing the hypothesis.
Yes. Thank you. Next question.
Okay, sir. Sir, my second question was, sir, for analyzing the data analysis, if we are for the experimental work, if I get around 10 to 15 or below 10 sampling size, is it possible for going through the data analysis like ANOVA or something else?
No.
Or correlation?
No. It will be too low a sample size. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, sir. Can I go for next question, sir?
Yes, please.
What are the difference between qualitative data and quantitative data?
Right. Very good question. And I guess a easy question kind of thing. I think we have already given a couple of examples here. Let me repeat here. Say, for example, when somebody falls sick and we have options to take him or her to one hospital and we don't have any monetary problem. I hope the person who has asked me is listening to me.
Yes, hello? Sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So suppose one of my family member has fallen sick, and I want to take to a particular hospital. Then the immediate factor comes the trust or the goodwill of that hospital. Should I take it to Apollo? Should I take it to AIIMS? Should I take it to AMRI? Now, if we ignore the money concept, so when you're talking of trust, so you have in your mindset some comparative scores. Maybe like Apollo is better than AMRI. So when you are comparing on the basis of parameter of trust, that trust is not a quantitative, it's a qualitative value, which is relative and it varies from person to person. So this is one example, I guess, like the qualitative variable is clear. Now quantitative, say for example, how child grows in height, in weight, every year. Suppose Anshuman may be interested to note the growth of our daughter, sweet daughter. So every year, I was doing that, Anshuman, for my both the kids, son and daughter. If you, I'm a student of statistics, as you know, I have my record. Say second year, what are the height? Third year, what are the height? I had recorded. So you better do that. So when I'm measuring height or weight or similar growth, I'm using some number, absolute number. Those are the example of quantitative data. Have I clarified the difference between qualitative and quantitative, please?
Yes, Shadow.
Have you understood? Have I clarified the difference between quantitative
and quantitative?
Yes, he has told yes.
Oh, yes, sir.
Message he has typed yes. Next.
Yeah.
Next question.
Okay. Next question is, sir, is it compulsory that the size of objectives should be same both in synopsis and the project?
My personal answer will be yes, it should be. We have discussed today, objectives can be put in two ways, broad objective and sub-objectives. And we should not forget that actually. Particularly the broad objective should never vary. Should never vary. That's my personal opinion. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. So it was the last question.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Apanaku bahut bahut dhanyabad, sir. Au apana amro nimantran rakha kari आउ जेतोले आमे रिसर्च एक्सपोर्ट पई आमे खोजिलु बीसी सर भी कहिले एंड आमे आमो डिपार्टमेंट सर को सहित कथा हलु पुनी अंशुमान सर को सहित कांटेक्ट करलि मु डेफिनेटली आपन को पाई के वी आर वेरी हैप्पी एंड आज मधे आमे फैकल्टी माने मधे स्पेशली मो कथा मु कहउची आई हैव लर्न अ लॉट फ्रॉम योर फ्रॉम यू
थैंक यू सर
प्रेजेंटेशन
थैंक यू सर
एंड आई होप वेलकम सर मु आशा करची सर नेक्स्ट क्लास रे मध्ये हमरो लर्नर माने बहुत संख्या जोग देबे एवं आपन को थारु आमे सिखिबु
आवा मन मन रक्षा कर मेसेज करचोन दी थैंक्स जनो चोनदी थैंक यू सॉरी
प्लीज कंटिन्यू हां आपन हमर निमंत्रण रक्षा करी सर रखी के आज हमर क्लास रे जोग देले सेइत पे आपन को बहुत बहुत यूनिवर्सिटी तरफ रु धन्यवाद एवं मु धन्यवाद देबी
ओ आगे व्यक्ति व्यक्तिगत भाव बहुत खुशी आम संपर्क आरंभ है निविड़ हम
सर 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 थैंक यू मुझे धन्यवाद देवी आम डॉक्टर अंशुमान जेना सर जी आम रीजनल डायरेक्टर अच्छा आज टेक्निकल सपोर्ट आमको दौंट सर एक्चुअली आप जान खुशी अंशुमान सर हि इज ऑलराउंडर एंड दिस
Thank you. his company always. Thank you so much. Can I log out?
Sir, thank you.
Yes, thank you so much, sir.
Thanks to all.
We look forward to your next session.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Hello. Hello.
So this session comes to an end. We look forward to your feedback. I have just shared the feedback link. Mo feedback link dei deichi. Apan mane ei session ku close kariya purburu ba log out kariya purburu. Apan mane daya kari se link re click karantu. Au apan kara valuable feedback diantu. Apan ka feedback ku ame samaste ebong amara higher authority mane dekhuchanti. And it also helps. It also encourages us to improve and provide better services to you. So thank you so much.
Looking next class, sir, kebe abo?
Participation. Next schedule.
Sir, next class kebe abo?
Next kali haba.
Asanta kali.
Website re bhi ha. Amro website re bhi update hai jai chhi sabu dinsa. Apan manne pooni next asi ki amasa hita join karantu. आपण माने डेफिनेटली एंजॉय करिवे सेशन सबगुडा आ आपण जहां भी पढिवे व्हाटएवर यू आर लर्निंग यू विल इमीडिएटली इंप्लीमेंट आपणकर जो प्रोजेक्ट कंपोनेंट अछि सेतरे आपण माने
तक इंप्लीमेंट करिवे सो दैट इज माय पर्सनल रिक्वेस्ट टू ऑल ऑफ यू थैंक यू
एक्सक्यूज मी सर
हां कोन तो प्लीज टेल मी
सर जदी जो सेशन जोटा होचे तार गोटे आउट फ्रेम जदी मेल कर दियंते तो इजी होनता सर एक्चुअली
वेबसाइट पे अपलोड हेची एवं आपण जो मेसेज जाउची बा हमें सबुतरे जो ब्लॉग बा कोन अछि सब्जेक्ट बा टॉपिक तार हमें रेफरेंस गुडा दे दउचु तो आपण से एसएलएम को जिबे तार देखिबे जहां भी कंटेंट अछि मोर ऑर लेस तारी ऊपर ही डिस्कशन हबो
अच्छा अच्छा
तो आमे ब्लॉग आउ कोर्स रो रेफरेंस दे दउ छै ना
सब डिटेल अच्छा अच्छा संभव न है ओके थैंक यू सर
आज्ञा आज्ञा तो आपण माने समस्त एबे लॉग आउट करि पारंती फीडबैक आपण माने दियंतु आउ नेक्स्ट सेशन रे आमे समस्त जॉइन होबा आउ आमे समस्त निजो को आपण को जदी नेक्स्ट माने सेशन रे आपण जदी को टॉपिक रे रिसर्च करू जंती आपण ताकू थ्योरी सहित रिलेट करी की स्पेसिफिक क्वेश्चन भी पचारी परिबे हमर रिसर्च जो रिसोर्स
दी सुबोधि सर होंतु बा सुमिता मैडम होंतु तांको आपण स्पेसिफिक क्वेश्चन पचारी परिबे सो दैट विल बी अनदर बेनिफिट की आपण डायरेक्ट इनपुट पाई परिबे रिसोर्स पर्सन मान कोटू आउ आपणकर जो रिसर्च अछि बा स्टडी अछि सेटा गोटे भलो शेप देई परिबे बा डायरेक्शन देई परिबे नमस्कार समस्त थैंक यू आउ थे भल सुस्थ रुहतु नेक्स्ट क्लास देखा थैंक यू आपने लॉग आउट कर
हेलो